very, what's the word I'm looking for? Very arrogant disposition, where they want to usurp. They think they'll just do it better. They're not even trying to work with us. They want to just override it because they know better. I have the obvious disrespect of that. What can you do with that when you have an internal group at odds? So I disregard that as well. If they're not willing to simply accept what we set up, that's already global now, it's already in motion, I have no comment on that. I say if you really support it, you'll do your work with us and with whatever organization you're doing simultaneously. So that's the way I look at it.
Okay, I was just referring to transition mostly and not like the ultimate goal, which is the reason based on. Okay, thank you.
This is the transition we're in right now. So that, I mean, we're in the transition, so everything that we're doing now is equally as important as it will be 10 years down the road.
It's kind of a little insane. It's my daughter who will try hard to indoctrinate.
Hi, Peter. I'm representing the Miami, Florida chapter, and we really don't have any problems getting information out, finding people who agree. Our problems come after that. What do we do after that? Most people, their exposure to the scientific method was high school chemistry. Now, how can we get them to begin to think in that technician's mindset and then apply that to their daily life and to how they view society? Like, what projects can we take on as a chapter to begin educating our community?
That's a great question. I think there's some wonderful texts on the Project Unreleased that if you break them into chapters, obviously Jock's book, and then Tyranny of Words is a great thought exercise book. It's got, I consider it quite scientific in its abstraction. There's also, there's a lot of big interest now in science and sanity, I've found, or science and sanity. A lot of books I can't really think of right now, but they force the inferential state of mind, if you will. It makes people to look at the cause of reality. Just like I outlined, you know, in part three, was describing from the ground up why reasoning of the society is what it is. So I guess we just simply have to kind of, if someone's new, try to get them into that mindset for the reasoning, understand the reasoning, and that's essentially what the scientific method of thought is, as long as the data set, of course, is correct. So you have to be creative with it, also think about who you're dealing with. If someone's interest is already in a field of science, then push them towards something that's related to the field that they're in, so they have identification with it. If someone is in an artistic context, then you would go in a very different way. You would give them, you wouldn't give them something so technically specific that they would do too much of it, you know? So I recommend taking the individual into account and trying to get active information going. What everyone should be doing at all times is learning. I think you'll forget that. Even I don't know everything. I haven't read everything in the Project Unreleased, even though I certainly want to. I haven't read everything that I have in this gigantic list that's subsourced, but it's all there and I will eventually do. It's a process of education. And getting people to understand just it as much as possible about what's relevant, as much as possible in relevant content, specifically to the resource-based economy. So, excuse me, by the way, I'm very jet lagged. So. That's a big question, and I would have to say that using the book sources as a starting point and pushing those books on those that have nothing to do, as you stated, and want something to do, and get your feedback on them, and have groups that talk and discuss those ideas, and also invent and create. That's another thing I definitely recommend, especially for those technically minded, to get them to think about how they would redesign North America, what parameters would they use, and why. What would be the self-evident generation? Is it just a whim of theirs? Are they actually researching it? You see what I mean? There's all sorts of thought exercises in there, which is why, as I mentioned, Mirth to Venus is so important. Like, I'm really looking forward to getting to that point. It's been a difficult programming complication as of now. To get people together and say, oh, wow, this is great. Think about creative fun that would be. To get people that are fluent in, you know, structured design, and start from the macrocosm and then hone in region by region about how you would design the most efficient societies. So I recommend all of that. Beyond that, it's all a matter of awareness and spreading awareness. Scientific method train of thought isn't something that you can just give somebody. Inferential assessment has to be as objective as possible. Human beings intrinsically, especially in this culture, are not objective. So they have to overcome their victimization of culture, you know, which we talked about like, as well. So I hope that kind of helps.
And but this guy one of the
Hello everyone, my name is, hello Peter, my name is Mihai.
Hi.
From Romania, I live in the UK. So I guess from Romania says hello, even if I don't really activate with them.
Thank you
very much. Now, my question is related a bit to a documentary I saw. I think the name was Ethos. It's a bit related to the Zeitgeist movement, although I'm not entirely aware of what the connection is, but there's a lot of ideas that were taken put into that documentary. I felt that it was a bit diluted to a certain extent, but the point is that they've used Woody Harrelson as a presenter for this documentary. And, you know, coming from that, I work in the car time business, which is more or less like advertising publicity, and I'm, you know, trained, conditioned to think a bit in this way. And I'm looking at all these movie stars, and the case of Woody Harrelson that was promoting that documentary, and I'm thinking, shouldn't our communications team maybe concentrate their efforts into getting a lot of these famous people and kind of getting them to spread our message, because they, you know, their impact is, you know, a thousand times more than my impact would be, to, you know, just kind of getting people to understand what this is all about. As I'm giving the example of Tom Cruise, for example, who is a famous Scientologist, although I don't even know what Scientology is all about. It's probably a problem.
Excuse me, what's your question?
Yeah, the question is, do you think this is a you know, a healthy direction that the movement should pursue right now into trying to get in these, you know, these famous people like singers or whatever?
No, absolutely. There's a thing, there's a project called the Zeitgeist Media Festival, which is a derivative of our Zeitgeist Media Project, which is currently a website where people upload various media that we've created and support the movement. It's really an artistic type of outlet. And with the festival, I'm going to do my best when I try this, hopefully late summer, to get as many famous people, at least well-known people, people that have an audience to come and perform at this. Hopefully, we volunteer. But there's a few people that really have shown an interest in this, so I completely agree that probably over politicians, over philosophers, people pay more attention to media personalities than anything else. I mean, our values, I think, in the Western world, is really groomed by the movies that people watch and the TV shows that they watch, from my experience. Probably more so than anything else. It's almost quite scary to see the influence that they have. So yes, it's pretty important. I didn't see the Ethos documentary. They contacted me and wanted to use chunks of my movie that's in it, and I had no idea when I saw it. Because someone sent it to me. I'm like, well, how do they use this movie? I got a little bit irritated because I didn't have memory of it. And nevertheless, Woody Harrelson being really surprised me. So that's amazing that they were able to do that. You know? So I completely agree. And anyone that has connections to any media personalities, I know that there was a campaign to contact lots of media personalities that were socially active a number of months back on the global website. So, yeah, hopefully, I think if we get maybe two or three, then it will, the breach will be made, and others will step forward and be able to not feel uncomfortable by supporting this direction. I think it'd be wonderful. I think it's also right around the corner, frankly. I know underneath the surface there are a lot of celebrities that you mentioned to me that do support this direction, but they just don't come out. They're not willing to talk about it because it's their identity that's at stake, so it has to be comfortable.
Right, last question, and it goes to this guy here.
Thank you, Javier. I've just got two questions. My first one relates to hydrocarbon technology, our addiction to it, and how do we wean ourselves off this technology and the geopolitics associated to it. How do you see us getting from where we are heavily addicted to the Venus Project, where we are not addicted? I know you've got a lot of questions about how do we get from here to there, but my question is mainly focused on energy. My second question is, have you considered a move into politics to take the establishment on, sort of head on, and sort of take the Zeitgeist movement forward to like a voting public where people could even like vote for it?
Well, the second question, politics is really something that at the end of the day would be phased out as we know it in the future. It's not a legitimate institution. It's not based on anything but people promoting values, the public identifying with those values arbitrarily, no information, no scientific understanding, no education, no scientific knowledge of city planning, of any organization. When Sarah Palin becomes president of the United States, I would not surprise me a second, it would be a perfect testimony to what politics actually represents. It's this mind-numbing system of complacency where people feel satisfied when they hit that voting button, so they don't ever think about anything anymore. It's a self-generating oppression system, if you will.
I guess what I'm saying is it's almost like a step progress.
Yep. No, I understand what you're saying, and people have brought this up to me before, using the political system as some type of soapbox, if you will. And I've had people say, oh yeah, I'll run for whatever and do it just for the publicity of it, which I completely support. I think it's beef to want money to do any type of political office run. So if someone has that kind of resource, I wouldn't do it. But I think somebody else, if they want to do it on that platform, especially if someone who's been in politics for a little while and sees the light, but they're already in it, and then they move and do it, because what they're doing is they're moving into a system that they actually want to eradicate, which is incredibly unique notion in itself. As far as the first question, the energy transition, we could do tremendous energy shifts right now if there was any interest to do so. Unfortunately, the investment that's required is so colossal, and the return is so distant. There's no monetary system driven by short-term gain. And if you can't get short-term gain, you have very little motivation, regardless of the lack of sustainability problems on the horizon. They should have been doing, even for the hype on global warming and climate destabilization, regardless of what you believe, it's obvious that oil is a problem in what we're doing. So even if oil wasn't real, there's still a very dire need to stop burning all of this stuff. They could have done this a long time ago, so there's a reason they're not. It's the monetary system that's the problem. So how do you usurp the monetary system in that regard? Frankly, it would take a huge investor right now to initiate that, which you'd think would be there as well, just for a multi-billionaire that's willing to step forward and initiate these processes, but that doesn't happen either. So to answer your question, is that it's really hindered by the system? I have no idea, except the fact that you have to bypass the system. As far as I'm concerned, as I mentioned in the film, you have to bypass the system if you expect to see a revision, a complete revolution, if you will, of energy infrastructure and energy sources on this planet, because there's no way in hell any government, any country can be able to afford it, especially now with the debt collapse that's spreading like a virus.
Yeah, I completely agree, and I think that the biggest threat to us at the moment is energy and our consumption, and peak oil is the biggest threat. I think that if you could raise awareness for that, I think the first step, you could actually have people vote for a government that would freely support a not-for-profit sort of development of alternative energy. So you could have, $700 billion, whatever it was, investment in or people where they'll work in not-for-profit to find alternative solutions to hydrocarbon technology, etc.
You'd help.
Yeah.
You would certainly help.
People like yourself, for example, were to, from government, whatever, where that was a big interest to wean ourselves off this technology, where people could go and research in an environment, in a not-for-profit environment, that's supported by the state, that could perhaps wean ourselves off such a thing, and then develop this technology in an environment which is not-for-profit.
I wish it was easy to do as easy as for you to say. You gotta bypass the ultimate element of the system that supports it, and that's the need for monetary acquisition at all costs and the maximization of that. And unfortunately, and that's why it's brought up in the film the way it is, everything that this system is about is against what you talk about, even with nonprofit institutions, even with governments. Look at all the attempts that's been made to try and get governments for decades now to change its energy policies, and what good has it done? I mean, even the Green Party, it's just, you'd think that the public would be all about a Green Party in some country, but they can't see it. They have far too much experience with their little dyad of liberals and Democrats and the arbitrariness, and they're not comfortable even moving them to something new, unfortunately. And so, all I can throw my hands in the air and say, I wish what you state would easily come to fruition. Obviously, your logic is sound, so I agree with that, but will it happen? Something's going to happen, that's for sure. I do know that.
Thank you all for coming, everybody.